How many books now, Philip?
There are 70 books that
70
I finished
books.
On marketing, but please, some if you're a critic, you'd probably say I wrote one book on marketing 70 different ways. That made originally pretty bad refrigerator. He called all the factory people together and he said, give me a hammer, and he hit his own refrigerators to say how bad they are.
Olá pessoal, aqui é José Salib Neto. Vou começar aqui com um convidado para lá de especial, mas bota para lá mesmo, né? É, professor Philip Kotler, o pai do marketing aqui diretamente de Sarasota. Trabalho com ele já há mais de 30 anos, né? Uma jornada incrível. Ele que não só fundou o pensamento do marketing, mas continua na liderança dele. Então, prazer. Philip, it's wonderful. Talk about our 30-something years relationship in management. You know, back then in the 80s in Brazil, being, you know, on together.
Well, Jose, our relationship has been one of my most treasured relationships. And when you called me over 30 years ago to come to Brazil, said that's pretty far away, but maybe I won't do it. And you said, but do you play tennis? And I said, I love tennis. I wish I don't get better at it, however. And you said, but a week of training from Mr. Number 19 in tennis in Brazil. So I was there. And by the way, that was the first of about 8 to 10 trips to Brazil.
Yeah.
Because you ended up, maybe my lectures were good enough for you because you kept calling me to come back and go to not only Sao Paulo and Brasilia and Porto Alegre, but I enjoyed it. Every visit to Brazil has been an eye opener.
How many books now, Philip?
There are 70 books that
70
I finished
books.
On marketing, but please, some if you're a critic, you'd probably say I wrote one book on marketing 70 different ways. That's not true. I've been responsible for a movement within marketing called the broadening movement, which is say that marketing is not just for companies. It's for organizations and people of all kinds. You know, we now have people reading books on my personal brand and how to build my brand. We have people in museums wondering what they could do with marketing to get more visitors. We have theater groups that want to fill the seats. So marketing is, you can't avoid marketing as any kind of organization. Even in the military, they want to get more soldiers to join. You got to be good at marketing the benefits of joining the military. Now with the digital revolution, we all have to figure out a new type of marketing, not the old type of mass marketing, which means that you're trying to get everyone, whoever they are, to drink Coca-Cola. Now, that works for Coca-Cola, but most companies better go into what we call segmentation, targeting, and positioning. Who are you trying to serve because they have needs and you can do a better job serving them? And once you decide on that, then you can do the four Ps. Oh, I know that group, so therefore I know the product that they will want. I know the price to charge. I know where to get the product and then how to promote it. So marketing knew that 30 years ago, but today, we are leaving the old advertising. You know, too many companies, probably in Brazil too, think that they're doing marketing because they're doing advertising. Get off that platform. That's no longer going to work. You're going to have to know much more about the groups and individuals who are buying your product or who might buy your product and know how to get the data on them so that you can almost customize the appeal by person to bring themselves to buying your product.
And Philip, how about you know, these intelligent mechanisms in algorithm and artificial intelligence, how that's going to impact marketing? How is that impacting marketing?
Well, basically, first of all, it all started with the social media. The ability for Facebook to get a whole bunch of people to talk to each other online, and therefore, for Facebook to be able to know who likes to play tennis, and it's not just Facebook, it's not just Instagram. Even when you go into a store and then you sign up and you pay your prices for the goods, that's information that's coming back to companies. They have so much information. So what we're talking about is data collection, Then mining the data, having certain techniques where you can learn from the patterns of behavior that you're observing to gain insight, not just knowledge. The key thing for a marketer is how do you get the hot buttons of behavior? How do you spot them? And that's going to be revealed by analytical methodologies. Even economics, by the way, has changed what it's all about. Instead of saying everyone is a rational buyer, they now say there's a new field called behavioral economics, where, well, frankly, marketing is behavioral economics, and you don't need to ask economists to do it because they don't know how to do it. Marketing is behavioral economics.
Philip, a lot of the technology people, and now they are the stars of the show, right?
Yeah.
They think they say that no longer you need a marketing director. The marketing guy is the technology. What do you think about that?
No, we got to be careful here because there is a creative side to coming up with ideas in marketing. So I think that great marketing skill is going to be a combination of blending. In a marketing group, the people who are into the old type of marketing, by the way, I've never said we should stop using advertising or traditional marketing or billboards or print. Keep those, but make them work better with the newer tools, which would be the AI and algorithms and so on.
Philip, what are the companies that you admire the most in marketing these days that are doing a
well?
Great job?
I think Amazon is blowing the whole idea of what a company is apart. The fact that it started just as a bookstore, yes, an online bookstore, and got to the idea that why not sell other things with their superbly customer-oriented idea of having product reviews. Returning, always being sure that the customer got complete value from being dealt with. So I admire when you ask what companies, I say Amazon, one can continually learn from. And Amazon's moving to the point where maybe they won't have much in the way of, they're always going to have a lot of assets, but basically a lot of their business is done through other companies. Wow. That is, they don't want to own all the stock that we are buying from them. Mm-hmm. All the stock is in the hands of the companies that are partners of theirs. Mm-hmm. And by the way, the idea of the modern company is that it should hold no assets.
Yeah, be more platform companies.
They are called platform companies. The company that excited me most was Haier. Haier is the Chinese company that made originally pretty bad refrigerators. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the head of Haier made a dramatic gesture. He called all the factory people together and he said, "Give me a hammer and a sledgehammer," and he hit his own refrigerators to say how bad they are, and organized a much better company, taking a big share in the United States, but now is organizing the whole management along very special groups of 6 to 8 people that he wants his own people to grow with ideas, to create ideas. It's not hierarchical anymore.
You've been, your last books being worried a lot about, you know, your Philip Kotler economist is talking a lot about economy and not so much about marketing.
Yes.
Tell me about your worry about the economy thinking.
Always in my mind, how to raise the standard of living of people and to advance the common good. When I noticed that capitalism was having a very deep problem in the concentration of income, that we were underpaying the workers and overpaying management. Mm-hmm. Now, you may want to argue with me, but I would say that I believe that if you transfer $100 from a rich person to a poor person, the two are better off eventually. Mm-hmm. The rich person doesn't suffer at all. He's got lots of money, and the poor person spends it, 100% of it. And that's keeping the factories of the rich person going. Mm-hmm. So my North Star, what guides my thinking on every problem is, does the solution advance the common good? By which I mean, does it make for greater happiness among more people. Because most of our thinking is what's good for me, or what's good for my family, what's good for my group. But when it comes to public policy, you got to ask what would make the world a better place for more people. And so that's what I recently came to. I realized that all my work was really about how to advance the common good. But the point is, I want to see what can be done to help a set of problems. Why do we have to have poor people and hungry people? How could you stand it if you have a lot of money? Not philanthropic. How can you be not philanthropic? How can you be not caring about other people? Mm-hmm. And then there's even a group now called the Patriotic Millionaires. Mm-hmm. These are they're not billionaires. They think their taxes are too low. They are organized to get the government to raise taxes mm-hmm. on richer people. Mm-hmm. And I make one condition. I say, the problem is some people will say, oh, then the money will be wasted by government. It will go into maybe defense that's not necessary. How about any taxes on the rich being only put into improving the education and the health of the people? In other words, the money collected from billionaires and multimillionaires goes into a fund that mm-hmm. is administered independently to advance the quality of the school system and college. Yeah. Then I would be very much in favor of that.
Philip, thank you so much for doing this for our audience. We love you in Brazil. You've been there so many times.
Yeah.
You have impacted so many countries, so many companies, and you can be sure that you have impacted us em Brasil. Thank you, Philip. Pessoal, o que eu poderia falar sobre isso, né? Realmente emocionante. E nos vemos em breve, tá bom? Um abraço. Tchau, tchau.